Welcome, everybody. My name is Mauricio Towen, and I serve as chair of the Department of Psychiatry at UNM. And I want to thank you for being here with us tonight. And let me just tell you a little bit about the department and where we're heading. Community engagement is a top priority for us. And we want to make sure that the public gets the speakers of topics they're interested in. Our speaker tonight is going to be talking about integrative medicine, otherwise known as alternative medicine. And we know that it's a topic that is of major interest here in New Mexico. We also want to make sure that these public lectures are known or identified with UNM and with the Department of Psychiatry. So there was probably some confusion when some people got the email, and I think it was called psych events, and maybe it was not recognized as ideas. And psych events is a very generic term. So in the future, it's going to come from UNM Psych. So you know that these are the We Need to Talk lectures. So we're going to continue with the We Need to Talk lectures, and we're going to also continue with Let's Keep Talking lectures that are usually comes after we have a national speaker, a faculty member will talk about the topic. So again, welcome you all, and let me introduce someone who is well known to all of you. Sam Keith, who was my predecessor and now in charge of We Need to Talk lectures. Sam.
Thank you, Dr. Towen, and good evening. With all the changes that are going on, I just wanted to reassure you that I'm still Sam Keith. And it's such a pleasure to see the department's continuing to expand its role in the community. I really feel that this is the right direction to go, and I think we've got great leadership taking us there. I also think that the We Need to Talk lecture series is a valuable component of our trying to talk to people in the community. We don't need to lecture to you, we need to talk with you. And we hope that we can capture that through many different approaches, and tonight just being one of them. It's great to see all of you here. We're especially happy to have Dr. Freeman, and I know you will be also when you get a chance to hear her this evening. Before we start the program, I have a few housekeeping items for you. First of all, I would like to thank all the volunteers that have helped make this possible, the smooth entry and distribution and all those sorts of things went very seamlessly and always has, so we do thank our volunteers. Our presentations always have a Q&A period immediately following the talk. We invite you to write down your questions, and we'll collect them right after Dr. Freeman has finished her presentation. Please be sure to write your questions clearly, because I have to read them, and if possible, be brief, because I have to read them. Tonight, we're very fortunate that one of our distinguished faculty members, Anila Del Fabro, a child psychiatrist in the department, will be doing the Q&As. We thought we'd try a little variety because you probably were tired of my style by then. In a few weeks, we'll be following up this presentation with our Let's Keep Talking programming. Dr. Judith Pence from our own department will lead these discussions both in Albuquerque and in Santa Fe, and you'll find the details in this evening's program. We also encourage you to fill out the evaluation form, and if you have something nice to say about me, please put it down in capital letters, write clearly, be brief, but be kind, and so that we can continue to ensure that you're getting the kind of information that is helpful to you. So I'd also like to note that the department now is developing an integrative medicine program within the Department of Psychiatry. So this will not only be an important lecture for our community, but also for our community within the department. Now, it's my pleasure to introduce tonight's speaker, Dr. Marlene Freeman, who's an associate professor of psychiatry at Harvard Medical School, and I'd like to welcome her back to New Mexico. She's been here a number of times in the past when she was at the University of Arizona, but now has moved on to the New Mexico of Cambridge, Massachusetts. She is also an associate director of the Perinatal and Reproductive Psychiatry Program at Mass General Hospital and the medical director of that hospital's clinical trials network and institute. Dr. Freeman completed her medical school at Northwestern University and her residency at Harvard Longwood Psychiatric Program, as well as a research fellowship in biological psychiatry at the University of Cincinnati College of Medicine. Her research and clinical expertise is in the area of mood disorders and women's mental health. Dr. Freeman is also the vice editor-in-chief for the Journal of Clinical Psychiatry, one of our most distinguished and important vehicles for information to the field of psychiatry. She's a distinguished fellow of the American Psychiatric Association and chaired its task force on complementary and alternative medicine, the subcommittee on omega-3 fatty acids in psychiatry, and was a member of the American Psychiatric Association's work group on major depressive disorder treatment guidelines. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Marlene Freeman.
Thank you so much. I'm extremely honored to be here tonight. I want to thank the Department of Psychiatry for hosting my trip here. I'm extremely honored to be visiting on behalf of the department. And I want to thank all of you for being here tonight and spending the evening with us. Really appreciate it. So we're going to be talking about complementary and alternative medicine in psychiatry, otherwise known as integrative medicine. These are my disclosures. So, starting off just with a definition. So, complementary and alternative medicine has been defined as a group of diverse medical and healthcare systems, practices, and products that are not presently considered to be part of conventional medicine. And, I think right off the bat, we kind of start out with a challenge because it's a really dynamic definition. So, for example, some things that might be considered not part of conventional medicine now, with more research and work in the area, may be considered conventional in the future. And so, it's a somewhat very subjective definition. So people really use the term in different ways, and what might mean complementary and alternative medicine or CAM to one person might be different to another. And the other thing about that definition is it really encompasses so many different kinds of treatments. And the definition really describes what those are not, that they are not part of conventional medicine. But they don't necessarily have a lot in common with each other. Some do, but some don't. And so I couldn't possibly cover all of the potential treatments that are considered under this category. But what I want to do is really highlight some of the ones that I think are most important in terms of mental health and psychiatric disorders. So that's what my goal really is tonight, is kind of bring to the forefront some of the ones with the most evidence base and some of the most popularly used. So why would we focus on this? So I think many of you by coming here are probably very interested yourselves, but it's true that Americans and in many other countries, there's really a growing interest in this area. So about 40% of adults use at least one CAM therapy per year. And not surprisingly, those who use CAM treatments are more likely to also be providing them to their children. Americans spend $33 billion out of pocket on complementary and alternative medicine therapies. Now that's really staggering, $33 billion, because the truth is that many of the therapies are not well studied, have not been shown to be efficacious for any disorders, and have not been adequately studied for safety. So I think that we really need to focus on ones that are and ones are not. And I also really believe that any complementary or alternative treatment should be held up to the same standards as what we would consider a standard treatment or a prescription medication, because we want to make sure that whatever individuals are using is really the optimal treatment and safe, and we really want to make sure that we can weigh the risks and the benefits just like we would any other standard conventional medical treatment. So in terms of the ones that are most highly used in this country, some of the natural non-vitamin, non-mineral products rank highly up there, with omega-3 fatty acids or fish oil being commonly used, other products as well under that category, breathing, meditation, chiropractic treatments, massage and yoga. And this is from a few years ago, so some of those may have shifted a bit in terms of growing popularity, I think, if any changes. So in terms of who uses these treatments, women use more complementary and alternative treatments than men do. Those between ages of 30 and basically 70 are the most likely, so that's a pretty wide gap, broad group. Those that have higher levels of education and those who have higher income are more likely to seek these treatments. In terms of use in psychiatry, a lot of what we'll be focusing on is on the treatment of depression, because that's where actually most of the study has been done. But we can certainly talk about treatments in other areas as well. So in terms of use in psychiatry, the number one indication that individuals seek out these treatments is for the treatment of depression. One study showed that that the majority of inpatients on an inpatient psychiatric unit were using complementary and alternative treatments at the time of admission. About more than half of those with major depressive disorder or other depressive disorders do use CAM treatments, and most don't tell their psychiatrists. And I suspect most psychiatrists don't ask. So these are popular and appealing treatments. In terms of treating psychiatric disorders, we want things that work. We want effective treatments, but we also want treatments that are acceptable to patients and treatments that are accessible. And so in terms of many of these treatments, they at least are acceptable and accessible, and so we really have to scrutinize efficacy for some of these treatments. And I had a colleague who I think coined a wonderful phrase, and that was menu of reasonable options in terms of treatment for disorders. So, in terms of psychiatric disorders and really any disorders that patients are being treated for, there's always risks and benefits and always potential side effects. And so what we want to do is make sure that we have really collaborative decision making between patients and healthcare providers and make sure that the list of reasonable treatment options is as long as possible so that patients can really, start with treatments that they would prefer to try. So one of the concerns that I have about the internet is that very often if you do internet searches of different complementary and alternative treatments, you end up with, really millions of hits for some of these. So if you're putting in a search term in a psychiatric disorder, you get like many, many hits, which will be infinitely more than the number of studies generally for that treatment and that disorder. So I think that the internet has the potential to give us the false perception that there are more studies than have been done sometimes. That's one thing that I think we have to be very careful about. Another consideration is that many of these treatments are available without any input from a healthcare provider. So you can go to almost any grocery store or drugstore and buy a lot of different treatments. And so one of the concerns about that is that many patients who suffer from severe disorders that can be incredibly impactful in terms of, functioning, even morbidity and mortality, really deserve, full evaluations and treatment that's monitored by a healthcare professional. And I think that the availability of some of the treatments that we'll talk about really puts an unfair and unwarranted burden on patients to really be seeking treatment on their own and monitoring that treatment on their own. And so I think the more dialogue we have between the public and healthcare providers about complementary and alternative medicine, the better position we're really in, to have that care be, rationally thought out and monitored both by the patient and by their healthcare providers. And in terms of healthcare providers, many healthcare providers don't bring up the topic. Many healthcare providers do feel uncomfortable with the topic and feel like they don't know enough to really weigh in. And so one of the things that we want to do is make sure that we have a really well-educated healthcare provider, workforce in terms of these topics, to make sure that that the expertise is there to match patient interests on these topics. So, the bottom line, though, is that in terms of real psychiatric disorders, so not just looking at some symptoms for as indications, but in terms of psychiatric disorders, very few treatments have been studied enough in terms of having an evidence base, for the treatment to know if they're effective and if they're safe. One other challenge is that for some of the treatments that are considered integrative medicine, it's very hard to come up with a control condition. So really the gold standard in looking at efficacy or effectiveness would be a controlled trial. So where patients are randomized to receive one treatment or another treatment, those are compared. And ideally a placebo-controlled trial where patients don't know what they're getting so that their expectations wouldn't impact the outcomes. And so you can imagine it's very hard to come up with placebo conditions for, say, exercise. Like we all wish we could exercise and not know it, right? And another condition that it's been challenging to come up with control conditions for is acupuncture. Because you would think that you'd really know if you were being stuck with needles or not, right? So, but with acupuncture, researchers have been incredibly creative. So there are sham acupunctures that are used as control. So where acupuncture that's designed to treat the condition is compared with what's called a sham acupuncture, where the acupuncture points are not those that would be chosen to treat the condition. Or also retractable needles, where a patient would feel pressure on the skin, but the needle is actually not inserted. So there's been a lot of creativity in terms of how to well study different treatments. Then one of the other problems is we have, you know, usually when we're looking in this country at the literature, we're looking at English language only studies, but a lot of these treatments have their roots in other cultures and other languages. So we may not have access to the full literature. So I was very honored to be on the APA's CAM task force a few years ago, actually had the opportunity to chair this. And we looked at controlled studies, so randomized controlled studies for treatments used to treat major depressive disorder, because we started out really not having a specific disorder in mind, but looking at the literature and found that there were very few treatments that were rigorously studied outside of major depressive disorder. So we developed a process for looking at methodology based on guideline processes. And then we looked at risks and benefits and also clinical application and interest of each of the treatments and decided really to do a very focused review. So the treatments that I'm really going to go into more detail about are some of those treatments that we looked at. And I think that they're very relevant in terms of commonly sought out treatments and ones that, you know, may or may not have a place as part of the treatment plan for individuals with depression. So we looked at omega-3 fatty acids, St. John's wort, S-adenosyl L-methionine, which is SAMe, folate and related compounds, light therapy, acupuncture, exercise, and mindfulness-based psychotherapies. And all these really there are a lot of research studies going on right now with a lot of these different modalities. So the reason I became interested in this is because I sought out to work in the area of perinatal mood disorders, so mood disorders during pregnancy and postpartum. And, you know, it's really challenging to treat pregnant women because pregnant women, rightfully so, don't want any unnecessary medication exposures and really are in a position to be highly motivated to seek out non-pharmacologic treatments for psychiatric disorders. And so kind of thinking about what a wish list would be in terms of potential treatments, we'd of course want something that works. That's the most important thing. Something safe in pregnancy, safe in breastfeeding, something moms and babies need anyways would be ideal. No carbs would be trendy. And tasting like chocolate would have been the home run. Now I have to say we've had plenty of open label chocolate studies in our research group. And while fun, you know, we haven't found efficacy, but you know, it's interesting because interestingly, chocolate, we're learning a lot about, especially dark chocolate, containing a lot of biologically active compounds, and I think I'll touch on that a little bit later. So it does bring me to the topic of research of omega-3 fatty acids in pregnancy and postpartum mood disorders. That's actually the best picture I ever took. Aww. Shameless to show baby pictures, isn't it? Okay, so in terms of omega-3 fatty acids, you don't have to play this game if you don't feel comfortable, but how many of you take omega-3 fatty acids? Okay, and how many of you feel very knowledgeable about omega-3 fatty acids? Okay, so more people take them than feel knowledgeable. But, you know, I think that people generally have had a sense that they've been studied. And so basically with omega-3 fatty acids, the two main omega-3 fatty acids that we're talking about are eicosapentaenoic acid and docosahexaenoic acid, which are my two least favorite words to say out loud in public with three microphones. Basically, there have been a number of studies, and they've all been conducted in different ways, different designs. Overall, there have been enough studies now in depression to have had several meta-analyses, which is really a study of studies. And generally, the results have been a bit mixed. So the majority of the meta-analyses show a modest benefit over placebo of omega-3 fatty acids. And most of the studies that have shown benefit over placebo generally have been add-on studies to ongoing pharmacologic treatment. So we do have a lack of monotherapy studies where omega-3 fatty acids are the only treatment that's used, a lack of studies like that really have shown a robust benefit. So a little more about essential fatty acids. So omega-3 fatty acids are polyunsaturated fatty acids, which just means that they have a number of double bonds in them. And really where the double bonds are is where like the number 3 comes in. So you can have essential fatty acids that are omega-3, omega-6, omega-9. But in general, it's really omega-3 that is very deficient in the American diet. It may not be the amount of omega-3 fatty acids that an individual takes in or consumes as much as the ratio of omega-3 fatty acids to other fats in the diet. So, for example, I haven't figured out how to take away the movement with the slides. I'm not that technologically minded, but basically what this slide shows is that there's competition for enzymes that metabolize omega-3 and omega-6 fatty acids. And basically, omega-6 fatty acids are overrepresented in the American diet compared to omega-3 fatty acids, which are underrepresented. So with omega-6 fatty acids, we see more and more based on vegetable oils and as we have had different processes in this country for raising livestock and more factory farming, we've seen the source of nutrients for animals that are later consumed changed from grass-fed, free-roaming animals to more corn and corn oil, like base type omega-6 products. So we basically have a shift of recent years and recent decades to omega-6 compared to omega-3 that was once originally in the diet. And so the omega-3 index, which has been coined, is the ratio of omega-3 to omega-6 fatty acids. So it's very possible that the amount of omega-3 someone needs to consume is actually less if they're consuming less omega-6 fatty acids. So actually the background diet matters very much. And many of the studies that have looked at omega-3 fatty acids in isolation as a treatment don't come close to taking into effect really the complexity of the diet. So we're really missing that. So in terms of the subcommittee, what we did look at before we really initiated our work was the work group from the American Heart Association and their recommendations for omega-3 fatty acids. And they looked at some of the cardiovascular benefits. Some have more robust evidence behind them than others. So one of the biggest claims to fame in cardiology is that omega-3 fatty acids reduce high triglycerides, and that's one of the consistently shown benefits. But their recommendations were that adults should eat fish at least twice a week. Patients with coronary heart disease should take in a gram per day of EPA plus DHA, which for most commercial brands would usually be about 2 capsules. So a fairly modest amount. And that a supplement of a higher dose may be helpful in patients with high triglycerides. So in terms of potential neuropsychiatric implications for omega-3 fatty acids, there are many ways in which they're postulated to work. So we don't have any one mechanism by which we're certain that they would have impact on mood. But there are many different theories and many things in terms of preclinical and animal studies and human studies that show different effects that are known to affect psychiatric disease expression. So in terms of the studies that have been done, the reason I'm showing you this slide is I just really want to draw your attention to how the major studies in this area have really been different. So the majority of these studies, which you know, I tried to color code it for you, in terms of the study design column, generally these have been either adjunctive or add-on treatment or monotherapy, which is in red. So the minority of the studies are monotherapy, and the monotherapy studies have not really panned out. So omega-3 fatty acids on their own have not been significantly effective enough in these studies to show a benefit. Now, I also have to draw your attention to the column of N's, so N equals in that column, because those are the numbers of patients that have been included in studies. And as you can see, they're very small. So if you have an FDA-approved antidepressant and you do a study, a placebo-controlled trial, of N equals 70, 28, you know, 83, you are very unlikely to show any benefit over placebo because it's just, you know, the way studies are done, there is a placebo effect in studies. You know, patients get a lot of attention being in a study, a lot of evaluation, they have expectations. So the placebo effect in depression studies is pretty high. So to me, it's kind of surprising that any of these studies showed any benefit. I think that, you know, considering the size of the studies, it's actually pretty impressive that there's any benefit at all among these studies. So in terms of the omega-3 fatty acid work group for the American Psychiatric Association, we did something that was not particularly bold. We endorsed the American Heart Association recommendations, and that we seriously consider them though, especially you know, relevant for individuals with psychiatric disorders, because we know that there are lifestyle factors associated with psychiatric disorders, like patients being more sedentary, more likely to smoke, more likely to use substances than the general population. We know that there are side effects, including weight gain, with many of the medications that we use very commonly. And so we did in some ways mirror their recommendations. Adults should eat fish at least a couple times a week. Patients with mood or other disorders should consume about a gram a day of EPA plus DHA. And we left a caveat that, you know, with a wide range, that higher doses may be helpful in mood disorders, because that's really what's been studied. And the good news is that the lower range actually appears to be the most effective. So 1 to 2 grams a day has actually panned out much better than the higher doses that have been looked at, which is good because, you know, in some of the studies, patients were taking up to 14 capsules a day, which is, you know, a lot of capsules, where 1 to 2 capsules may have a meaningful benefit. So switching gears to St. John's wort. St. John's wort is a very popular antidepressant treatment in Europe, and I think has really waxed and waned in popularity in the US. So it's generally studied as hypericum extract, although there are other there are other elements in St. John's wort, which is an herb that may be antidepressant. There have been a good number of randomized placebo-controlled trials in major depression, and many of them have been positive studies. I think some of the interest really waned in the US when two large studies didn't show a benefit of St. John's wort over placebo. Interestingly, in one of those studies though, sertraline, which is Zoloft, didn't show a benefit over placebo either in that arm. So, that's actually part of doing research trials, is that in many of those, there's no separation from placebo. But I think that that my sense is that St. John's wort isn't as popular as it was before some of those trials. It's definitely less popular, I believe, among American psychiatrists. But it is a readily available treatment that's in a lot of different stores. And one thing that's very important about it is that while there may be benefits, there are enough double-blind placebo-controlled trials to certainly support some antidepressant efficacy, the safety really needs to be importantly considered. And there are serious and important drug-drug interactions between St. John's wort and other medications that a patient may be taking. Those include some heart medications, antiretrovirals, includes oral contraceptives, and we, you know, if those of us who prescribe really don't want to mess with the efficacy of oral contraceptives. So this is important because a lot of times if people are buying a supplement, they don't necessarily know the downside to it. It's not necessarily on the bottle. So it's, you know, it's very important that that healthcare providers are well educated about this, but also the general public. And one of the really, you know, interesting things in research in this area is that we're studying compounds often that are very accessible to the general public. And from one of the St. John's wort studies that have been done, they actually looked at blood levels. And interestingly, they found detectable levels of St. John's wort in patients that were taking placebo. And they found some patients who were supposed to be taking St. John's wort had non-detectable levels. So you know, when we have, you know, some of the compounds that are available, people may be very excited that there's a study being conducted on that topic and may go and seek it on their own. So this is a slide to show you a little bit about folate metabolism and different folate compounds. And there certainly won't be a test at the end of the day, but just to kind of give you a sense, you know, there are different folate-related compounds that occur in like our natural process of our bodies, and in terms of like how our body, you know, methylates or metabolizes, you know, certain compounds. So in each of the steps where there are arrows, there are enzymes that, you know, basically take a compound from one step to the next. And so that's where some of the different agents you may hear about are different, is that they're basically an enzymatic reaction away from being, you know, related to another compound. So in terms of those of interest, we have folate and folic acid. We have methylfolate, which is being studied as a treatment for depression. And we also have SAMe, which is S-adenosyl-L-methionine, which we'll also talk about. But these are all, you know, kind of in the same family. So in terms of folate and folic acid, so natural sources versus synthetic in terms of the two labels, there have been studies showing low folate levels in individuals who have depression. There have been treatment studies add-on looking at folic acid added on to an antidepressant showing more rapid benefits and more pronounced benefits in individuals who receive folic acid compared to placebo. There is not evidence treatment for monotherapy, but it is something that's considered low risk. There is some debate whether individuals in general should indefinitely take folic acid supplementation ongoing. There have been some concerns about excessive folic acid supplementation in some cancers developing over years. One of the areas where this is a nice fit is actually in perinatal psychiatry or reproductive age women. So I think one of the most, you know, groundbreaking findings in medical history really is that folic acid can prevent some birth defects. And, you know, it's really important in terms of preventing birth defects, in terms of women having it very early in pregnancy, and very importantly also before pregnancy. And this is actually known to be so important that there are many foods that are available to us, many processed foods actually have boosted amounts of folic acid in them, so cereals and bread products, because it's so well known about how important it is to have adequate folic acid in terms of preventing birth defects. A very interesting group of studies has recently come out also showing that folic acid supplementation pre-pregnancy, so right before pregnancy and right after, may also help prevent autism. So there definitely is an important role in terms of women of reproductive age. Interestingly, though, too, you know, if you think about it, you know, women who are pregnant or postpartum are, you know, really the most folic acid supplemented people on the planet, right? Because prenatal vitamins have a high amount, but they're not protected against depression, and we know that from a lot of studies. So really, on its own, it doesn't seem like it's adequate for protection or acute treatment of depression. So S-adenosyl L-methionine, you know, the nickname is SAMe. is one of the best studied and most efficacious treatments among all these that we would consider supplements or integrative medicine or complementary or alternative medicine. There have been decades of research, not only placebo-controlled trials, but actually comparator trials using standard antidepressants compared to SAMe. Also, and generally those studies mostly show benefit over placebo and similar efficacy as prescription antidepressants. The limitations of these studies is that for some reasons most of them have been very short. Some studies do show a pretty rapid benefit in terms of onset of some benefit within about 10 days, which is pretty rapid for the treatment of depression. One of the limiting factors is that it's expensive. It's not that expensive relative to some of the other treatments that we would consider complementary or alternative, but you know, these treatments are rarely covered by insurance. One of the other issues about it is that it needs to be protected from too much light and heat or it turns to goop. So like if you see it in packaging, it's generally blister packed in opaque containers. And some of the early researchers in this area actually questioned later results with negative studies when they found that the potency of what they were using was very weak after not being stored correctly. There have been some case reports of mania in patients who are treated for depression, so those with underlying bipolar illness, which many antidepressants also carry the same risk. And it's generally well tolerated, but there have been some side effects, especially some mild gastrointestinal symptoms and sweating and dizziness have been reported. So most of the time, SAMe is used as a standalone treatment, like an antidepressant. There was recently a study by one of my colleagues at Mass General looking at it as an add-on treatment, so in addition to an antidepressant, which did show a benefit. And one of the newest treatments in this folate family has been L-methylfolate. And L-methylfolate really comes into play because many individuals have genetic variations where they don't fully metabolize folate efficiently. So L-methylfolate actually skips over some of the limitations in the metabolism so that individuals who are not good folic acid or folate metabolizers sort of like jump the more difficult enzymatic conversions that they don't do very well because of genetic variability. So there have been some studies of augmentation of L-methylfolate, and so far these have been add-on treatments, generally, looking at a couple different doses with the higher dose being effective for major depression that was not responsive alone to an antidepressant. And so it may be particularly effective in individuals who know that they have this genetic typing. So bright light therapy has been studied for a very long time. So typically the way it's delivered is, you know, it's bright light therapy. So this is another thing on the internet that there are all sorts of different types of light therapy and light boxes. But what has really been well studied has been bright white light therapy. And typically individuals would buy a light box. They can be rectangular, but they can come in different shapes. And they generally need to be in front of the light box, about like a foot and a half or so in front of the light box, facing the light box. Not staring at it, but facing the light box. They could be reading or doing something else, but in front of it for about 30 minutes in the morning is the typical protocol. So sometimes people don't know what the protocol is and they have the light box in, you know, on while they're in the room doing other things, but that's not really what the effective dose that's been studied. Now, 7 years in Arizona, I did not convince one person to buy a light box. But I have had a lot of patients in Massachusetts get light boxes. I have to say that only one incredibly persistent patient was able to get her insurance to reimburse her for the light box. So the good news is that they pay off in spades because they last a really long time. The bad news is it does require a financial investment up front of, I think, anywhere from about starting at about $200 to, you know, $400, you know, depending on the light box. They may have come down a little, but they're not cheap. But sometimes, I have known of psychiatrists who have bought some for their practice and then lend them out. So they have been most studied for seasonal, or initially studied for seasonal depression. They're also very well studied and have been shown to be efficacious for major depression that's not seasonally related. This is what they look like. So basically, one would have to be, you know, pretty proximate to the light box to have it work. The other thing about light boxes is that there is a particular risk if an individual has an underlying bipolar disorder, that they, if they have a previous diagnosis, they're being treated for bipolar disorder, or they may not know that they have an underlying predisposition to be manic or hypomanic. And so in a lot of studies that have been done, there have been reports of patients switching from depression to mania or hypomania. And interestingly, these have been studied for depression in pregnancy. And really, in all those studies, that has been, you know, the one major side effect of using a light box. And they don't, they're actually filtered for UV light, so you don't have to worry about a skin exposure with these. Acupuncture is another modality that's being looked at for psychiatric disorders. You know, part of, I think, the difficulty in really understanding acupuncture in Western medicine is that it really is from a, you know, completely different systems of medicine and diagnostic symptoms. In general, there have been some studies looking at depression, major depression, and in those that really have, you know, rigorous diagnosis and treatment methodology, overall there hasn't really been a robust finding in terms of general antidepressant effects, although there have been, you know, studies showing other benefits and in the area of well-being. So they have been, you know, fairly difficult to study in terms of coming up with adequate controls. One of the areas where acupuncture has looked very exciting is in terms of treating depression during pregnancy. So there have been a couple very exciting studies showing a benefit of acupuncture with two different control conditions. So one is sham acupuncture and one is massage. And interestingly, there has been data showing that massage itself may have antidepressant effects in pregnancy. So the fact that acupuncture would beat massage in those studies is very promising. So this is an area that I think is still under a lot of research. So with exercise, exercise has been studied for a long time, clearly has antidepressant benefits, but we know a lot of that from patients who don't necessarily have major depression when they're being studied. So we're looking at mood benefits, not necessarily in those who are seriously ill. But there have been studies, a lot of studies looking at depressive symptoms in patients with comorbid medical disorders. And there have been some rigorously done studies for major depressive disorder also. You know, exercise is hard to study. It's very difficult to come up with a control condition. So in one study, the group was randomized to exercising or having snacks in a little social group. And you know, those are, you know, very, you know, wildly different. Also picking what type of exercise. So is it observed exercise sort of like in a lab on a treadmill, or is it instruction to do exercise at home? You know, how well does that work? And now that actually, I think that it's so exciting now that we have all these like monitoring devices and pedometers and all the different, I actually have to disclose I'm wearing a Fitbit. So I'm not getting any steps right now. But I had so many patients coming in and showing me their like different devices that I just felt like I had to try it out. But you know, interestingly, you know, a lot of people who don't necessarily engage in what they would call like actually formal exercise are very active people. Where I would have to say, at least speaking for myself, that psychiatrists not very active in their everyday jobs. So you know, it's interesting because there are different ways to conceptualize exercise as just doing like the 30 minutes on the treadmill, and I think we do have an opportunity to really study it so much more now that we have all these monitors. So, you know, how to design these studies is really very challenging. So most of the studies do really support a promising role in terms of antidepressant efficacy. We really need more research to look at, you know, how effective is it for patients with moderate to severe depression? So typically, you know, this would be part of a treatment plan. It wouldn't be the only treatment that someone who is, you know, truly suffering from serious depression would pursue. But it's hard to really think of a situation where we wouldn't recommend that for patients as part of the overall treatment plan. Yoga is actually is a treatment that's receiving a lot of study right now. There are several federally funded studies looking at depression in different contexts. There's a researcher in Rhode Island that's been looking at yoga for the treatment of depression during pregnancy. It's being studied for a lot of different indications. You know, it's really interesting because yoga involves a lot of components. There's an exercise and physical component and a mindfulness component, and it'll be interesting to see in those studies, you know, really what the elements may be or the types of yoga that may be most beneficial. But right now, I would say that, you know, this makes sense as an add-on treatment, but really, I think, doesn't have enough evidence to be someone's main treatment. So vitamin D has actually really become very popular in terms of patients, individuals being tuned into what their vitamin D levels are. You know, I think, you know, coming from the Northeast, we're more and more commonly getting vitamin D levels on patients and finding out that they're very low. And, you know, really the main reason we would do that is bone health. So in terms of psychiatry, it's really like at its infancy of knowing kind of what its importance is overall. But when we're talking about vitamin D, what we're actually talking about is a hormone. It's a hormone, and it links up with receptors that we have. And there are different forms, but it's vitamin D3 that's the active form generally. So most supplements are vitamin D3, and the form that we can most use in our bodies is vitamin D3. Now, we talked about light boxes. So the light boxes, because the UV light is filtered out, the light box doesn't work by increasing our vitamin D. That's not the mechanism for light boxes. So, you know, one of the main indications would be, you know, overall general bone health. Now, there have been a number of studies showing that individuals who have depression have lower vitamin D levels. And so we can't really get cause and effect out of that. So it may be that things about depression, like perhaps staying indoors more, could actually account for lower vitamin D. We don't really know the answer to those association studies. Basically, right now, though, with treatment studies for vitamin D, this is vitamin D. For treatment studies, we've had like very few, you know, rigorously done treatment studies, you know, and the ones that have been done, some have been done actually in populations without major depressive disorder, but looking at depressive symptoms, and some have been done specifically in patients who are of older age. So there's some promising information, but it really is too soon to say that vitamin D functions as an antidepressant. So calcium is very interesting, really has not had much of a role in terms of the treatment of mood disorders, but there actually is a, you know, fairly convincing literature looking at premenstrual syndrome and premenstrual dysphoric disorder. So of all the complementary and alternative treatments that have been looked at for that, it really has the most evidence that showing that after two or three menstrual cycles that women notice some benefit both in physical and emotional symptoms. So again, for women who are suffering from premenstrual dysphoric disorder, which is can be a very serious and disabling condition, this would be, I think, very reasonable as an add-on treatment and part of the plan. So I mentioned chocolate before. So interestingly, about half of women crave chocolate premenstrually, and not surprisingly, it's incredibly refractory to treatment. So there is actually a controlled trial looking at progesterone versus alprazolam versus placebo and chocolate. And not surprisingly, none of them were helpful for the treatment of chocolate cravings, which are incredibly treatment resistant. What is surprising, though, is that any hospital's ethics board would actually allow this study to take place. So there are many different theories why people may crave chocolate, and there have been, you know, some studies, you know, that have been very popular in the media showing that there may be benefits, you know, antioxidants. You know, we know that there are some biologically active compounds. So I'm staying tuned into this area of research. So I wanted to just also talk about nutrition in general. So nutrition in general and mental health, because I think it's an incredibly important topic. Like we would really, you know, with a lot of these studies, it's so easy, you know, it's so much easier to study a capsule than it would be to study overall nutrition. Nutrition is very complicated, and even studying someone's dietary intake is very complicated and challenging. But we know that individuals who have psychiatric disorders are more likely to be obese or overweight. They have a higher burden and risk for cardiovascular illness. We have eating disorders, among the disorders that we treat, which, is very important in terms of, nutrition. There's really growing evidence of dietary patterns and future risk for problems with mood. And an area of research that I think is incredibly exciting is the study of transgenerational effects of, primarily maternal diet during pregnancy and risk factors for her offspring, which is a really interesting area of research. So there have been now several different studies looking at nutritional intake patterns and risk for later depression, and some studies also looking at anxiety. And so generally these studies have used long-term studies that are prospectively designed, meaning that patients are enrolled and then followed over time. And then information is gathered about their diets, often by food frequency questionnaires. So they're not recording what they're eating every single day, but it's often a snapshot, or they're filling out different questionnaires about their intake. And it really shows that diets that are high in processed foods are associated with higher later risk of depression. And that there are certain patterns, like a more Mediterranean diet, generally like whole foods, healthy fats, healthier meats, higher in omega-3 fatty acids are more associated with protection against development of depression versus what often is the typical American diet, which is a lot of processed foods, a lot of sugar, and a lot of the fats that we worry more about. The other thing, too, is that individuals who have obesity are also at higher risk of going on to develop depression. So it's a really complicated bidirectional relationship, I think, between nutritional intake and obesity and all these different factors that go in. And really, there are few areas that are so complicated, I think, as dietary intake. It's really the quintessential biopsychosocial activity. So, it's cultural, it's affected by who are around, it's family oriented, it has socioeconomic variables associated with it. So many different factors, it's very difficult to study. So we talked about this before, fat in the American diet. Generally, omega-3 fatty acids are anti-inflammatory, and in terms of many disease processes, anti-inflammatory components are very important in terms of management of chronic health conditions. So not just mental health, but general health in general. And as we've really seen shifts in how food's produced in this country, this has really become kind of more and more bad news. So what I think is so exciting, and I am always excited about pregnancy and women's mental health related information, but what I think is the potential durable long-term consequences of diet on future generations. So there have been some studies, mostly in animals at this time, looking at intake during pregnancy and then outcomes and consequences for the babies or pups in these studies. So this is one study that looked at in utero exposure to the maternal diet. They looked at basically metabolic effects. So how fats are processed, how sugars are processed, things that in humans are highly related to cardiovascular illness and poor cardiovascular outcomes. And they found that basically with higher amounts of omega-3 fatty acids and lower amounts of omega-6, basically there was some programming, so better outcomes in the next generation, really suggesting that there's programming that even in spite of the exposures that the baby may have to different nutritional ways of eating and nutritional sort of diets, that there is going to be a vulnerability that they inherit based on what they were exposed to in utero. And this has been true, and from another very elegant study showing that the maternal high-fat diet has a profound influence on the immune response and some of the behavior and cognition of offspring. So we have not really, adequately studied this in humans, but I think with the animal studies, I think it really underlines the importance that we do that, and that we also really emphasize nutrition to pregnant women. And, you know, it is so complicated because, you know, we can't really separate out individual nutrients. You know, we have, you know, like, you know, the whole complex diet. And so it makes it really hard to study. And then the other thing is how many other variables go into what we eat. So there's, you know, the cultural and environmental impact. There's, you know, what foods are accessible, which, you know, different neighborhoods have different access to different foods. You know, really socioeconomic influences can be very profound here. Marketing, there's really been a lot of controversy about marketing, you know, on Saturday morning cartoon shows to kids and around education. There's been, you know, very wide debate about this, sometimes like vicious debate over like school lunch programs, what should be included, what should not be included, you know, what is in the best interest of public health versus autonomy, and should the cupcakes come to school, should the cupcakes not come to school, you know, but really like it's been extremely controversial. So, you know, I think steps along, you know, these paths are going to be, you know, potentially very challenging and take, you know, really, if there will be changes, a lot of sort of collaborative action. And so in terms of what it means for clinicians, so I think clinicians should be actively engaging patients around discussion of their nutrition. So we often ask about appetite because it's often a symptom of psychiatric illness, but we need to definitely be talking to people about what they eat, you know, where they eat, you know, are they eating like basically alone or with a family? Can they afford, you know, healthy foods? And then the other thing, you know, this Department of Psychiatry is very rich in expertise in child psychiatry and infant mental health, which is very unique. So, you know, it's interesting also that to think about the position of children. So as we're talking about nutrition, because kids are really dependent on, you know, other people to provide the foods that are in the house and what's going to be at school, and they have peer pressure also as another factor. So studying children's mental health, I think, can be even more complicated. And it has been shown in studies where maternal nutrition has been looked at, where there's been some intervention, like different, for example, one study that looked at like different omega-3 supplemented foods, like either eggs or nutrition bars, looked at different supplements, and they found that you could not really do a study where you give a food to the mother and only to the mother. So you'd really have to make it available to the whole family, or the woman would preferentially give the healthy food to her kids. So it really may be that we need to study families rather than individuals. In terms of public policy, there is really a lot of debate, and we also don't know really what the most effective moves would be to really change behavior. So, you know, nutritional behaviors are very hard to change. Behavior is hard to change in general. And so, you know, some states and cities are experimenting with posting calories on, you know, the menus. And so, you know, it's interesting because when they looked at some of the initial outcomes in New York City on this, it was those that were of higher socioeconomic status that were really affected, you know, made different decisions based on the calorie count. And it may actually have been, you know, some of the education around what does it mean that it has this many calories? Is it more healthy if it has more calories? So they interviewed, you know, they did some focus groups to see how patients understood that. And not everyone knew, you know, exactly what was important about looking at the calorie count. Do you have that posted on menus here in New Mexico? Okay. So I have to say that I have changed my mind in line at a coffee establishment at an airport once, you know, based on having those largely posted. So they are sometimes very eye-opening. Okay. So in terms of research, what we really need to do, first of all, if any of you have any ideas, I would love to hear them. So when we are having more of a discussion, you know, this is an area where we need a lot of creativity and we need a lot of collaboration, you know, between the public and healthcare providers of all different disciplines. So there are so many areas of like food intake that we need to understand, and so it's really a very, very challenging area for us. So in terms of basically treatment recommendations, sort of where do we take this practically here and now, I think that it's really important that healthcare providers are very engaging with patients about different complementary and alternative treatments that at any meeting with a patient that will, like, for example, we ask about medications the patient's taking, is to specifically ask about other, you know, supplements, herbal treatments, or other complementary alternative treatments that they may be doing. They may not think to mention supplements, but also they may not think to mention the light box or the acupuncture or mindfulness-based treatments that they may be doing. And also make sure that we educate patients that natural is not always safe. So there are a lot of natural things that are not at all safe. So like arsenic is natural. And so the other thing too is that you know, the supplements that patients have access to are not regulated with the same vigilance as pharmaceuticals that are FDA approved. And so even if, you know, we usually want to know more about the actual components that the patient is buying the supplement for, but very often we don't know very much and can't know very much about the purity. Now, there are some sort of self-imposed industry regulating bodies where makers of different supplements can voluntarily, you know, basically seek a stamp of approval and have their supplements submitted for analysis. And so many supplement companies will have this information on their website. And if you're taking a supplement and you want to know more about it, you can actually contact the company and really ask for some of their quality assurance data. And some of them have excellent quality assurance data. Probably if you don't get a response, you might want to reconsider the brand. But really, I think starting at the websites is a really key place. So in conclusion, I think that this is an area that really is very exciting, needs a lot of research, and also needs a lot of skepticism. Like, we really need to make sure that that individuals who are suffering from illnesses really get the treatments that they deserve. And we really want the list of potential treatments to be long, but we also, you know, don't want to be too forgiving of any treatments that don't meet specific requirements in terms of being effective and being safe. So I think on this note, we're going to be switching to more of a discussion format.
Thank you very much, Dr. Freeman. And I know a lot of information was presented tonight. We will have the video of this lecture available in about 2 to 3 weeks on the Department of Psychiatry webpage. So for those of you that would like to refresh your minds on what actually took place here tonight, I think that that would be a good place to start. While we're getting set up for the questions and answers, let me introduce Dr. Anila Del Fabbro. Dr. Del Fabbro, who will be leading the question and answers part of our program tonight, is an associate professor of child psychiatry in the Department of Psychiatry. She's also director of the Child Psychiatry Residency Fellowship Program and has done an outstanding job there in the community. She also serves as vice president of the New Mexico Association for Infant Mental Health. Now, with those of you that have questions, please pass them to the sides, and we will then pick them up. So, Anila, do you want to come up?
Hi. So I'm just going to see if everybody could hear me.
Can you hear in back?
All the way in the back, can you hear me? Great. So I'm going to wait for some questions. I do have one to start with. Thank you so much. That was wonderful.
Thank you.
And one of the things that I know in speaking to children and in speaking to moms, that's something that we do forget to ask about. And one of the things that I find very important is sleep. If a kid's not sleeping, we're in trouble. So I was wondering what you thought about melatonin and whether that had come up.
I'm glad you brought that up. So, because I get this question a lot, so should women who have trouble sleeping during pregnancy take melatonin? And, you know, so melatonin is a hormone that naturally occurs in the body, and it's, you know, generally released, especially at certain times of the day, to basically trigger the brain to know that the time to sleep is coming up. And it has had a good number of studies, with the most efficacy really shown in older adults, and for jet lag, so for resetting your internal clock as you cross time zones. And in general, the other studies for insomnia have been not as robust. And there have been really very few studies, I think, in children with pretty much a lack of long-term follow-up. And there is some animal data with melatonin showing that that in utero it may actually affect sexual development, fetal development. So I actually advise pregnant women not to take melatonin, and I would worry about giving children melatonin. I know it is very popular among, at least where I practice, among pediatricians and child psychiatrists, but I respectfully disagree completely that it should be given to children.
We are bombarded on a daily basis with any number of dietary substances or food groups that are associated with a higher risk of different illnesses. So could you discuss the difference between associated with and caused by?
Sure. So so many of the studies that we look at, not only in nutrition, in some of these, you know, different nutritional elements, but you know, many of the studies that we look at in terms of healthcare and treatment in general are association studies. So they look at individuals who have a certain diagnosis, and then they may look at certain elements in the diet or certain blood levels of different compounds that are related to nutritional intake. And so an association would be that the patients who have this disorder have a higher level of vitamin X than patients who have another disorder. And so that's hypothesis generating, but it doesn't say that that higher or lower levels of that nutrient cause the disease or protect against the disease. It also is possible that having the disease in some way lowers or raises the level of the nutrient, or it could be another factor completely. So generally, the association studies that we see are best for generating hypotheses to look at cause and effect. So if we're looking at risk factors, we really need longer studies. So really at a baseline, before individuals have the illness, you know, what are the factors, and then follow people out over time, you know, to see who actually develops the illness and who does not. And those are very, very expensive studies to do.
Right. So a question regarding nutrition, that seemed to cause a lot of questions, the nutrition part. Recently heard that beef has amino acids that benefit major depressive disorder.
That's interesting. So I have not heard that. I actually haven't seen any research specifically looking at individual amino acids used in the treatment for major depressive disorder. I'm afraid I can't really comment on that.
I think that's a chocolate question, maybe.
I will say yes. That there is evidence that, you know, like naturally raised grass-fed cows, or I'm not like really a cattle expert, but like, you know, are higher in omega-3 than factory-farmed animals. So that could potentially have
an effect.
Implications.
Do you know of any reproductive psychiatry resources here in Albuquerque or New Mexico? That is, physicians, groups, organizations that can provide support to women off of medication for mood disorders during pregnancy.
So I'm so glad you asked that. It's such a timely question, because this Department of Psychiatry here is has and is growing a women's mental health division, and Anila is actually running that program, and we've been meeting, you know, much of the day about that.
And so, I didn't write this question.
You didn't write. So I'm glad whoever asked the question, because I think it's important to know that those resources here exist. And I think that it would be important, very important, to have community input in terms of what sort of resources would be most helpful in building that program.
Absolutely, and I'd be very interested to hear that at another time. This is an interesting question. Can you make a light box yourself at home? Are the specifications, directions on the internet?
That's an interesting question. I know I could not make a light box at home. I think it has to do with the power of the, you know, it's generally, like if you were a physicist or really like understood the elements that went into creating a light box that was 10,000 lux, which I actually wouldn't even begin to know how to do. Like, you could potentially do it. I wouldn't know where to begin doing that. So I think it would be very complicated.
We do live close to Los Alamos, so maybe we can get some input
well,
there.
Well, the other thing is, it's very, living in such an amazingly beautiful climate with a lot of sunny days, walking outside and sitting outside and getting natural light also has some antidepressant benefits. It's not studied the same way, like for major depressive disorder necessarily, as using the light box, but there are definitely known antidepressant effects of natural sunlight.
So one of the other questions asks whether light therapy affects serotonin and dopamine.
That's interesting. So I believe that there's been some translational research which would look at sort of the biological mechanisms, but I'm not very familiar with studies that have been done to really look at the biological mechanisms of light. Did you have a question, sir?
Well, I just did.
10,000 lux for, so the a comment of getting a light box for $70 off the internet, that's 10,000 lux. Yeah, that's great, as long as it meets that specification. I mean, I think, and is it the typical rectangular shape box?
It's not very big, it sits next to my bed very easy.
So I bet actually that's where the cost differential is, because traditionally they've been really large. And so I think that's fantastic. That makes it much more available to people. Thank you.
There's another question
back.
Way at the back.
So a comment that one psychiatrist got the VA to pay for a light box. That's wonderful. The VA, is an enclosed system, which really is, accountable for all its costs. So I think that it's a very cost-effective treatment. So I'm really glad to hear that.
I'm not sure which interesting question to ask next. Is alcohol a CAM treatment, and is it effective?
Alcohol? Is alcohol a CAM treatment, and is it effective? Effective for what?
I'm not sure. I guess it goes with the chocolate. Maybe it's champagne, strawberries, and chocolate. I'm not sure.
So there have been no treatment studies looking at alcohol as an intervention for psychiatric disorders. But, more seriously, that substance abuse and alcohol can really confound the treatment of psychiatric disorders, where, using alcohol in large quantities is really makes the prognosis much worse for treatment.
And I think for psychiatrists, we tend not to ask that as much either about substance use, and I hope we're getting better at that. Are there inflated costs of medications for depression one of the reasons why patients may choose CAM over prescription drugs?
That's a great question, and I would have to say no, because most of the antidepressant medications are now available generically. There are very few that are branded now, brand name, and actually for a doctor to prescribe one of those when there are so many generics, like, I need to write a letter to an insurance company to even have that patient's prescription be able to be filled, a prior authorization. And like every time I need to do a prior authorization, I think, am I going to be able to justify this? So it's usually a patient who's really tried almost everything else before they would get to something that's brand name only. So typically, the copays for generic medications are not very high, where the out-of-pocket costs for a lot of these treatments, which are complementary or alternative, can be very high and are typically not reimbursed at all.
Absolutely. And so certainly we have some undocumented patients in New Mexico, and it's $4 for a generic. Why do you believe pharmaceutical companies have not developed CAMs and gone through FDA approvals?
That's interesting. So so one of the challenges in developing what's sometimes called a nutraceutical, but like a supplement, and having it be able to be profitable, is that if something is going to be approved by the FDA, it generally takes an enormous amount of money to get an FDA indication. So typically, large-scale trials have to be done. And we were talking earlier about the high placebo response in many studies. So that means you generally need hundreds of patients who are going to be in clinical trials. You need multiple clinical trials to demonstrate to the FDA that something works. And for a lot of these complementary and alternative treatments, you know, they're not patentable. So they're naturally found. You can't necessarily claim that, you know, you're the only company that can make it. And so to invest what can be like millions and millions of dollars to get that FDA indication, it may be, a tremendous loss. It may not be at all cost effective. So I think that there's actually a disincentive for companies to put in research dollars into these treatments.
Okay, so this is the last question. How does the fact that patients studied in research of CAM self-select for higher patient activation and health behavior and inform the validity of the controlled trials?
That's interesting too. But I'm just trying to get the sophistication of the second half of the question. Is the question generally, are patients who seek out CAM research studies different than those who seek out standard antidepressant research studies? I'm going to assume that was the question. If that was the question, they're not very different on a lot of parameters in terms of demographics, depression severity. We actually did a meta-analysis of antidepressant treatment studies, including some of the CAM treatments. We aren't able to look at some of the complexities asked about in the question, in terms of some of the different treatment-seeking behaviors. But in terms of generally being more commonly women, that's consistent with what we find with just CAM use in general. But they don't tend to vary much in terms of depression severity or having a different placebo response. The placebo response in CAM trials is very similar to placebo response in standard antidepressant trials. So there doesn't appear to be that much of an influence on expectation of benefit.
Okay. Thank you.
And again, just a couple more words. We are committed to extending our education to the community. We want to bring speakers who talk about topics of interest to the community. And we also want to bring speakers who can, like Dr. Freeman, speak a language for what we call intelligent lay audience, not just a scientific audience. So I think we reach our goals today. November 5th, we'll have the follow-up. Let's Keep Talking, where we usually have one of our faculty members. And again, the information that you will be getting is going to be coming from UNM Psych. But again, it's November 5th. So thank you all for being here with us tonight.